Gildan Media presents Your Coach in a Box, affordable, life-changing audio programs.
The Power of Being Yourself, a game plan for success by putting passion into your life and work. Joe Plumeri.
Foreword by Joseph A. Califano, Jr. I have always believed and taught my children that the measure of a person's success in life is whether the individuals and institutions that person engages are better off because of that engagement. That's what makes Joe Plumeri so special, and what makes this audiobook so important. From his upbringing on the streets of Trenton, New Jersey, throughout his life, up to the pinnacle of national and international corporate leadership, the people Joe has worked and competed with, agreed and disagreed with, and laughed and cried with, will tell you how enriched they are from that experience. How Joe Plumeri does it, his passion for life and leadership, his ability to learn from tragedy, his uncanny penchant for making impossible dreams come true, is what his life and this audiobook are about. For our nation and people, at a time when confusion and conflict can blur the lines between right and wrong, when problems seem intractable, when many individuals find obstacles insurmountable, Joe serves up the experiences and lessons of his life as a robust anthem of hope, just by being himself. Remember the high hopes of the 1960s, even amid all the trauma of those years? We were going to conquer poverty, provide health care for the elderly, make it so any kid could go to college, clean the air and water, put a man on the moon. In this new century, we traded hope for despair. Cities go bankrupt, Washington is imprisoned in political gridlock, drugs threaten millions of our kids, the path of upward mobility seems too steep to climb, public schools fail to teach children how to read, write, and add. People have reached the point of shrugging and saying, it isn't even worth trying. Joe Plumeri has an answer for those people. He says, of course it's worth trying, and you can succeed if you put your heart and your passion into it and dare to be yourself. The audio book you are about to listen to just might be the most important book you listen to this year because of the message Joe delivers. We must instill hope in our people again. We've got to have heart and learn to trust our instincts. We must start talking to each other. We must start laughing. We need to rub up against each other, open up to each other, take a chance on connecting, get a sense of what it's like to walk in the other guy's shoes. And above all, we need to find the strength and fortitude to be ourselves. If we have the courage to do these things, we can eliminate the scourge of hopelessness that haunts our national psyche. When I went to work for President Lyndon Johnson as his chief domestic affairs aide, he said to me, they tell me you're pretty smart, way up there in your class at Harvard Law School. Well, LBJ said, let me tell you something. What you learned on the streets of Brooklyn will be a damn sight more helpful to your president than anything you learned at Harvard. LBJ was right. It's the same with Joe Plumeri. Joe learned a lot as a CEO of companies from New York to London. But what he learned on the street corners of Trenton about what makes people tick is going to be a far bigger help to our people than anything he learned in the corridors of executive suites. Like all of us, Joe is human. He's made mistakes, but when he slipped, from that fall he learned not only how to get up, but also what to do when he got up. He revealed one of his mistakes as he chaired a banquet at the Pierre Hotel in New York. When I stepped down as chair of CASA, the National Center on Addiction and Substance Abuse at Columbia University. The guest speakers included LBJ's eloquent daughter, Lucy Baines Johnson, Ben Bradley, the storied editor of the Washington Post, his wife, Sally Quinn, and the legendary lawyer, Brendan Sullivan. Steve Croft of 60 Minutes was the master of ceremonies. But of all those sparkling stars, the one that shone so brightly that it mesmerized the audience was Joe Plumeri. Most everyone who was there remembers that night because of Joe. A black tie dinner like this draws a pretty hard-nosed audience, with lots of jaded guests who keep talking at their tables during the speeches. But when Joe opened up from his heart about why he was chairing the dinner and why he was on the board of CASA, the audience, at first startled, was then suddenly so rapt that you could have heard hair grow. Joe told the story of his son Chris, all the troubles his boy had with anorexia and drug addiction, his child's years in and out of treatment, and how it all ended with Chris dying from an overdose before he reached the age of 40. Joe, his eyes tearing, told that room that he should have done more to try to be there for Chris. He wanted each of us to learn from his mistakes, to do all we could to be there for our loved ones, give them a hug, listen to them, make changes in our own lives so that our children, in turn, could be there for their loved ones and the people who matter to them. As he spoke, some guests cried. Some cried so hard they had to leave the room to compose themselves. Over the months since, many who were there that night told me Joe's talk had profoundly affected their own lives. In this audiobook, Joe Plumeri reminds us that human expressions of honest feelings and heartfelt emotions are characteristic of personal renewal. Joe's audiobook tells his personal story to inspire and spark in you the kind of individual passion that will lead you to play your part in order to usher in a new day marked by hope and achievement. Joseph A. Califano, Jr. was President Lyndon B. Johnson's chief White House assistant for domestic affairs from 1965 to 1969, and he served as Secretary of Health, Education, and Welfare from 1977 to 1979. He is founder and chair emeritus of the National Center on Addiction and Substance Abuse at Columbia University, an attorney, and the author of more than 12 books, including The Triumph and Tragedy of Lyndon Johnson, The White House Years.
Prologue, The Boston Marathon Tragedy. It brought tears to my eyes when my son Jay told me he decided to run the 2013 Boston Marathon as part of a charity team. Jay wasn't a serious runner, more the kind to go jog a couple of miles now and then. But he was ready to run 26.2 miles that April 15th in memory of his brother. That happens to be Chris's birthday, Jay told me. This way I can run for Chris. The race fell on what would have been Chris's 44th birthday. He died suddenly in 2008 after years of battling a drug problem. Chris could have had his whole life in front of him. Losing him devastated our whole family. I think about my son Chris every single day and challenge myself to learn from the mistakes I made in not being there for him when he was growing up, not showing him I loved him, not spending enough time with him because I was too caught up in my career. Ever since then, I've tried hard to be there for Jay, my younger son, and Leslie, my daughter, in ways that I could not for Chris. There was no way I was going to miss watching Jay run in this marathon for Chris. We made it a family outing. Jay was on the course running with CJP painted in black on his arm for Christian Joseph Plumeri, and Leslie and I roamed around taking in the scene in Boston. The day was beautiful, with the sun shining, the temperature climbing into the mid-50s, and an electric buzz of excitement building among the crowd along the course. People were cheering and chanting and smiling and laughing. There were people out there running who were 70, 80, and 90 years old. I saw people running as Roman warriors with helmets and shields. I saw one person running as a hot dog. I saw another running as a hamburger. You know that expression, dance like nobody's watching? These people were running like nobody was watching. Talk about being yourself. I was struck to notice that most were running for someone else, not themselves. They held up signs like Friends of Griffin or God Bless Sally. I did a double take when I saw two people running together, one with a hand on the shoulder of another. What was going on out there? It turned out that there were blind people running. Can you imagine not being able to see, running 26.2 miles or running 26.2 miles strapped to a blind person to lead them the whole way? Up front, they had people in wheelchairs with someone running along, pushing them for 26.2 miles. One guy was running along pushing a specially built wheelchair with an arrow that read, "This is my son." None of it was about running. It was about who these people were. It was about grit and spirit and heart. It was about being fulfilled by setting and reaching a goal, no matter how crazy it might have seemed, and it was about helping others to reach their goals. The context happened to be a marathon on a beautiful New England day in April. The real meaning of the event was the passion and the heart and the commitment and the dedication people were showing. Wesley and I found a spot near the mile 15 marker in Wellesley to wait for Jay, and when we spotted him, the joy I felt was indescribable. "This is for Chris, Dad," Jay called out. "This is for Chris." I started to cry. How could I not? Leslie snapped a picture of the two of us together, me briefly matching stride with Jay. Then we waved him on his way, and we're on the move, eager to find a spot as close as we could to the finish line. Leslie and I worked our way through the crowd and paused in front of the Lenox Hotel, which is on Boylston Street, about a half a block from the finish line. We took in the action from there for a while, but the crowd was piled up about six deep, so I thought we could do better. "It's going to be a while before Jay finishes," I told Leslie. "Let's try to move up." The finish line was full of small wonders. A couple behind us started to cry when they saw their daughter finish. Some of the runners would get to the finish line and lift their arms like they were Rocky running up the steps of the Philadelphia Museum of Art. You could almost hear the Rocky theme swelling in the background. Again and again, as someone approached the finish line, the big crowd would roar its approval. You could see how the exhausted runner fed off the energy. There was such joy in the air. Such a feeling of ecstasy. You could inhale it and be filled up by it. Leslie and I were making good progress, walking over toward the finish line, until we came up on bleachers that blocked our way. We were stuck, but only for a minute. That was when the first bomb went off. It was so close, only 100 yards from where we were standing. I could smell it. Explosives have a very distinct smell, which I knew from my days in the Army. I grabbed Leslie, and we started to run. The second bomb went off where we'd been standing a few minutes earlier near the Lenox Hotel. I looked around us, and I saw severed limbs and carnage all around and heard the screams and the moans and the yells. "Dad, there's a leg there and an arm there," Leslie said, pointing. Tears of ecstasy and celebration had turned into tears of horror. Everywhere you looked, there were people who had been injured, and I didn't see a single person who was hurt who was not being attended by someone. Random people in the crowd were doing what they could to help. There were runners draped in plastic sheets after finishing who didn't have cell phones and couldn't find their loved ones amid all that chaos. People all over were helping strangers get in touch. In the middle of the horror and chaos, I was inspired to see the way people joined together to help each other. The way even tragedy can bring people together. Even in agony, I saw the best in people. I was frantically looking for Jay. Never in my life was I so happy that he was a slow runner. I knew he was at least 3 or 4 miles away when the first blast hit, but at a time like that, when nothing makes sense, my mind started to go haywire on me. What if I had it wrong? Or what if he'd suddenly turned into Alberto Salazar and run like a gazelle the last few miles and finished ahead of schedule? What if somehow he'd been hurt? What if he'd been taken from me? Even if I logically knew I was crazy to think like that, the thought of losing another son had me in panic. I said to myself, "God can't be that cruel." I walked up and down Commonwealth Avenue, past runners in their capes, looking like refugees. I must have walked 15 miles searching for Jay. He didn't have his cell phone, so he had no way of connecting. Where could he be? If I saw a policeman, I would ask where they were sending runners who could not finish because of the blasts. I asked strangers on the street. I asked anyone I could. I kept looking at my phone, hoping for good news, and finally I got a text message from a number I didn't recognize. It said, "Heading for the Ritz." Could it be from Jay? If so, it was a very casual-sounding message. I called the number and got the voicemail of a girl named Jenny. Maybe Jay had asked to borrow someone's cell phone to text me. Only one way to find out. I hurried over to the Ritz, and there was Jay, casually sipping a beer. In the confusion of everything that had happened, he hadn't watched any video of the aftermath of those bombs going off. I hugged him and cried joyous tears to feel my own flesh and blood alive and well. But even when I tried to tell him about all I'd seen that day, it didn't really connect for him. Then the next morning, he finally watched some news reports, and the full magnitude of the tragedy hit him, and he called me to tell me about it. "Holy shit, Dad," he said. "I just saw what happened." They say when you're about to die, your whole life flashes before you. I had the feeling that day of every emotion known to mankind flashing over me. In seconds, I went from ecstasy to agony, and everyone in the crowd did too. I felt every human emotion. It was breathtaking, from the ecstasy and the joy of being with my daughter, being with my son, seeing my son run from my son, and all the emotions that go with that. More than anything, that day made me feel lucky. I was lucky my son Jay was not hurt in any way. I was lucky Leslie and I moved when we did and were not hurt. If I had lost her, I don't know how I'd ever have found a way to move on after that. I was lucky I got to see how powerful glimpses of human good in the reaction of all the people after the explosions ripped us all loose from any sense of reality. But I was also lucky I had those great hours before the acts of madness turned everything upside down, the beautiful day and the inspiration of seeing people running for other people. The day was a reminder of the difference between ideas you pack into your head like slogans and the core truths we know in our hearts and carry with us every day, whether or not we choose to listen. Life is a great teacher, and different periods of my lifetime have taught me different principles, which I will do my best to convey over the course of this audiobook. It was a day that reinforced for me how the richest and most joyful emotions are connected with sadness and disappointment, and that if we want the good stuff, we might open ourselves up to some sorrow. If we want to cry tears of joy, and who doesn't, then we might also need to shed some tears of sadness. Through those tears, we are more ourselves. Through those tears, we live life more joyously and more fully. We have a better shot at nurturing the relationships that matter to us in life and being there for people, not failing them as I failed my son Chris all those years ago. But it goes beyond that. If we can live in the moment and be honest and true in our emotions, that carries over into how we live all facets of our lives, including how we do our jobs. We live in a world where people without heart or vision, getting by on following the status quo, the statistical analysis, the robotic stuff that has everything to do with what's easy and nothing to do with what's right. The heartless too often takes precedent. Texting and email are impersonal. Leaders of business and politics too often base their key choices on impersonal polling data or the impersonal advice of consultants. Let me ask you a question. Why is it that we live in a culture where being authentic and human is always celebrated, and yet when someone is human enough to shed a tear, they feel they need to apologize? People say they had to fight the tears. Why the hell are they fighting back tears? Like it's a criminal offense. Like it's a felony to cry in public. They talk about almost losing it. What have you got to lose by being honest and true and human? What is it about our culture that makes that disallowed except at a funeral or a wedding or a catastrophe? You won't find anybody who says they don't like authenticity and keeping it real, and yet they apologize for crying. The golfer Fred Couples gave a great speech when he was inducted into the PGA Hall of Fame in 2013. Fred was talking about one of his mentors, Super Mex Lee Trevino, who helped him out when he was young. At one point, Fred had to stop speaking because he was on the verge of tears. He found his way forward, and then toward the end of the speech, he interrupted his prepared remarks and blurted out, "This is the coolest night of my life," and openly broke into tears, raised his arms in triumph, and walked off the stage. I loved it. That was a human moment. He didn't mind showing the world who he was. I choked up watching at home and felt great crying along with Freddie. He's usually a cool customer, but this time he was overcome and he showed it. And that gave a glimpse of the authenticity of the guy who I always liked. Yet crying is seen as a show of weakness or as a sign of having no discipline. People seem to believe it's somehow a bad thing. It offers a glimpse of their true identity that they would rather hide from the world, but nobody has a problem with expressing themselves in an email or a text. I really believe people will say things they wouldn't say in front of you because you're not there to see their reaction. You're not there to be the recipient of their wrath. How many people now use texts or emails to fire someone or to ask for a divorce? Why do they do that? They do that because they don't want to be there to see someone's emotional reaction. So we're only authentic when we're writing an email or a text because the person is not there when someone is reading. We are becoming more and more an inauthentic society. I'm no swami. I'm no guru. I'm a guy from New Jersey who talks like a guy from New Jersey. With my hands, sure, but also with my heart. I'd like to encourage you to join me in trying to get back to what matters. This is an audiobook to apply in your life and work. I've been a CEO for years. I've made a lot of tough choices and learned from them. I've made a ton of mistakes and done my best to learn from each and every one of them as well. I could do an audiobook focused only on making good choices in the business world, but I want to aim higher. I want to write a book for everyone, and I'm betting I can make you laugh, make you cry a little, and above all, inspire you. I'm going to give it my best shot anyway. I'm going to take a regular New Jersey guy approach to talking us all past the cloud of fear and hate and sourness that hangs over the country. All the things that inspire us most, self-sacrifice, generosity, courage, and hope, are qualities in short supply these days. Everybody's a robot. Everybody's too scared, too busy, too stressed to be human. How can we regain our bearings? I say it's simple enough. Listen to your heart and share what it's telling you with anyone you can. Leave fear and worry aside and step into the full light of joy and happiness. That's how you find it in you to be yourself. And let that be enough, more than enough. I've been able to follow my passion in life and make that work for me beyond my wildest hopes or expectations or dreams. I'm a person who feels what I feel all the way, and I wouldn't want it any other way. I laugh more than a lot of people do. I smile more than a lot of people do. And I shed a tear or two more than a lot of people do, too, especially most other men. That's how it is when you live your passion, you follow it, and you feed it. The passion isn't just a fixture in your life. It is your life, and it is who you are. You can't do passion halfway. That's not passion. Living your passion means you're all in. You trust your heart and trust your gut, wherever it takes you. You savor the joy and the hope and that feeling you have when you know you've left everything on the field and you've given it your all. Feeling strong emotion, even sadness, tells you you're alive. It proves that you're turning into your passion. Loud and clear. Passion is something every single person has or can have. Even if they've got problems, even if they've had it up to here with their jobs or their marriage or their whatever, still they can find passion in their lives. It might take a little work, a little courage and patience, but if they nose around and get down to it, there's some part of their life where they can find it. If you've lost your passion, find it. You've got to find it. Because if you don't have that deeper emotional connection to your life, professionally, personally, somewhere in your life, then you're hollow. There is nothing that can ever truly satisfy you. There's no purpose. Living your passion is not only the best way to feel good and feel engaged, to feel excited and powerful, but is also the best way to keep your bearings when all about you, others are losing theirs. It will make you happier, and it will make you better. Principle 1. Everyone has the same plumbing. Wall Street is an insular world. If you spend decades in that corporate culture, as I have, you can start to think you're not able to connect with people from other places, especially far-off places in foreign countries. People there talk funny. They have different ways. But my time in London working for the insurance broker Willis starting in 2000 reminded me that when you come right down to it, we all have the same plumbing. Before that time, I would tend to think of English people and German people and French people as being somehow strange and unknowable, but not after my time at Willis. The September 11, 2001 attacks had an impact on all of our lives. That's a given. But I think we could have learned more from the events of that day and their aftermath. People from Alaska to Alabama were all glued to their TV sets. Everybody felt united in their sense of anguish and grief. We cried together for the victims of the terrorist attacks on the World Trade Center and on the Pentagon in Washington, and we cried some more for their families and cried some more for ourselves and what we all lost that day. Those tears brought us together. They made us all feel united in being Americans. But the rest of the world was watching as well. From the first moments after the news broke of the two planes slamming into the Twin Towers, people around the world made clear that they saw the attacks as attacks also on them. French President Jacques Chirac declared, "In these appalling circumstances, the whole French people I want to say here is beside the American people." The leading French newspaper Le Monde, never shy about following an anti-American line, trumpeted a front-page headline declaring, "Nous sommes tous Américains." We are all Americans. The British were so moved that the Queen gave the order to play the Star-Spangled Banner during the ceremonial changing of the guard at Buckingham Palace. The largest gathering in the world honoring the victims of the September 11th attacks who died in New York, Washington, and Pennsylvania was actually the one that took place in Berlin, Germany, where more than 200,000 people gathered in the city's storied Tiergarten Park to cry together during a performance of Amazing Grace, and the German president, Johannes Rau, cried out, "America steht nicht allein." America does not stand alone. Many of my friends were killed when the Twin Towers crumbled. I was devastated. But you know what? I was surrounded by people who also were devastated, and I happened to be in Copenhagen that day. All around me were Danish people who had never even been to New York, had never set foot inside the World Trade Center. These people were as sad as I was. I watched them cry all around me. I kept thinking to myself, these people are not even Americans, and they're crying too. Everybody truly was an American that day. As a New Yorker abroad, I was blown away by the reaction of the Danes that day. It's so true that the things that unite us as people are far more important than the things that divide us, no matter where we were born, no matter where we live. But why does it need to take wrenching sadness to bring us together? Can't we also be joined by tears of joy? Can't smiles and laughter also draw us together? Looking back, I can't help but wish I'd seen the tragedy as a wake-up call to focus less on my career advancement and more on getting back to being there for my family, for Chris, and my other kids. Deepak Chopra, who once taught at Harvard Medical School and later became a spiritual leader in California, might actually have made the statement on September 11th that I most wish I had thought about more at the time. For me and my family personally, September 11 was a reminder that life is fleeting, impermanent, and uncertain, Chopra said. Therefore, we must make use of every moment and nurture it with affection, tenderness, beauty, creativity, and laughter. I don't talk fancy like Deepak Chopra, but his words track closely with my message here in this audiobook. Why not spend every minute of the day staying open to the idea that with a smile or a kind word or a well-timed action, you can make someone feel good? You can lift them up a little. Help them laugh instead of scowl or frown. Smiles and laughter bring people together, which can be more than nice. It can also inspire good teamwork and communication and that indefinable deeper sense of common cause that makes all the difference in making something happen with a company or in life. The main thing is to have the courage and the faith to be yourself. If you know you're going to do the work and you have the talent and the drive, you don't need to worry about putting on a mask or trying to act like a robot. You can relax and let a little spontaneity and joy into your days. It took uprooting myself to London for me to have a real moment of questioning myself on some of these basic beliefs of mine. I'm serious. I almost did, for a minute. There was something about that whole British stiff upper lip thing that could throw you off. They came across at first glance as so proper and so very English. It's human nature that when people are different, our first reaction is to see superficial differences as mattering more than they really do. Here's how it unfolded. I was with my first wife, Nancy, in Paris. I'd left Citigroup at the end of 2000 after 32 years, figuring I'd done all I could do there and change would do me good. But a change to what? I didn't know. So I signed up for a trip to France sponsored by the College of William & Mary, my alma mater, a hike through Burgundy, a boat ride along the Seine in Paris, and a visit to Roland Garros Stadium for the French Open. The night before the boat ride, Nancy and I took a little walk starting at the Hotel Bristol, where we were staying, along the Rue de Faubourg Saint-Honoré, right past the Elysee Palace, where the French president lives. As we were walking along window shopping, we ran into Henry Kravitz, who had become a partner at Bear Stearns at age 30 and went on to create the leverage buyout business, becoming a founding partner of Kohlberg, Kravitz, Roberts & Company, known as KKR. Henry and I had met earlier in the year through Lou Eisenberg, a great friend of mine for more than 20 years who had one of the biggest hearts of anyone I've ever known. Henry knew I'd left Citigroup. "What are you going to do with yourself now?" he asked. "I'm looking for my next adventure," I said. We laughed at that, and I figured that was the end of it. But then Nancy piped up. "Maybe you could find him a job," she said to Henry. It was a throwaway line, a mere pleasantry, but it got Henry thinking. "I've mentioned a company we have that could be a good fit, Willis, a global insurance broker headquartered in London." I had no interest. Insurance, London. To me, the commercial insurance industry was way too stodgy. And for a Jersey guy like me, London was not quite my neighborhood. "I'll call you," Henry told me. "We can talk about it." "Sure," I said. What was I going to tell the man? No? True, I had zero interest in getting into the insurance business in London. Talk about your fish-out-of-water stories. I'm a New Jersey guy, a New York guy, but being gracious only...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.